when Paul and I got engaged, he was planning to be a psychiatrist. So I thought I was marrying this like scholarly literary psychiatrist, and then he surprised himself and me by being one of those people who loves the operating room, and obviously he loved the brain and loved these sort of critical crisis moments, and both of those are true in psychiatry and they're true in neurosurgery, and I don't really understand people who love the operating room. It's like really cold in there and your patient's asleep and it's like, I don't know. But I think he was so like, compelled by what he could do for people.
I'm very pleased to welcome you to this evening's program, Lucy Kalanithi, in conversation with Neil Shah. They'll be discussing When Breath Becomes Air, the heart-rendingly beautiful and moving book Lucy's husband, Dr. Paul Kalanithi, wrote after he was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer.
I think what we're going to do is just have Lucy start off with reading a few passages and then we'll jump right into a conversation.
I flipped through the CT scan images, the diagnosis obvious. The lungs were matted with innumerable tumors, the spine deformed, a full lobe of the liver obliterated, cancer widely disseminated. I was a neurosurgical resident entering my final year of training. Over the last 6 years, I'd examined scores of such scans on the off chance that some procedure might benefit the patient. But this scan was different. It was my own. I wasn't in the radiology suite wearing my scrubs and white coat. I was dressed in a patient's gown, tethered to an IV pole, using the computer the nurse had left in my hospital room with my wife Lucy, an internist, at my side. I went through each sequence again. The lung window, the bone window, the liver window, scrolling from top to bottom, left to right, front to back, just as I had been trained to do, as if I might find something that would change the diagnosis. We lay together on the hospital bed, Lucy quietly, as if reading from a script. Do you think there's any possibility it's something else? No, I said. I had received the plastic arm bracelet all patients wear, put on the familiar light blue hospital gown, walked past the nurses I knew by name, and was checked into a room, the same room where I had seen hundreds of patients over the years. In this room, I had sat with patients and explained terminal diagnoses and complex operations. In this room, I had congratulated patients on being cured of a disease and seen their happiness at being returned to their lives. In this room, I had pronounced patients dead. I had sat in the chairs, washed my hands in the sink, scrawled instructions on the marker board, changed the calendar. I had even, in moments of utter exhaustion, longed to lie down in this bed and sleep. Now I lay there wide awake. A young nurse, one I hadn't met, poked her head in. The doctor will be in soon. And with that, the future I had imagined, the one just about to be realized, the culmination of decades of striving, evaporated. Flush in the face of mortality, many decisions became compressed, urgent, and unreceding. Foremost among them for us, should Lucy and I have a child? Even if our marriage had been strained toward the end of my residency, we had always remained very much in love. Our relationship was still deep in meaning, a shared and evolving vocabulary about what mattered. Having a child had been something we'd always wanted, and we were both impelled by the instinct to do it still, to add another chair to our family's table. Both of us yearning to be parents, we each thought of the other. Lucy hoped I had years left, but understanding my prognosis, she felt that the choice, whether to spend my remaining time as a father, should be mine. What are you most afraid of or sad about? She asked me one night as we were lying in bed. Leaving you, I told her. I knew a child would bring joy to the whole family, and I couldn't bear to picture Lucy husbandless and childless after I died. But I was adamant that the decision ultimately be hers. She would likely have to raise the child on her own, after all, and to care for both of us as my illness progressed. Will having a newborn distract from the time we have together? She asked. Don't you think saying goodbye to your child will make your death more painful? Wouldn't it be great if it did? I said. Lucy and I both felt life wasn't about avoiding suffering. Years ago, it had occurred to me that Darwin and Nietzsche agreed on one thing. The defining characteristic of the organism is striving. Describing life otherwise was like painting a tiger without stripes. We talked it over. Our families gave their blessing. We decided to have a child. We would carry on living instead of dying.
even just looking at this room and the look on everybody's faces as you were reading, it's just a glimpse into the impact that the book has had and the way that Paul's words and your words have moved so many people. And in the foreword, Abraham Verghese explains the power of the book. At the very end of the foreword, he talks about how it's about the content and but also about the very evocative absences. The actual quote is, he says, listen to Paul, and the silences between his words, listen to what you have to say back. And it almost seems engineered. You know, Paul is writing this for all of us. It's engineered so that we project our own life experiences onto it. And so I guess my first question is, what has it been like for you over the last 4 months to get this kind of response and to be the receiver of all of our projections?
In a practical sense, being the receiver of projections is sort of actually really great and a helpful thing for me during a time of grief. There's someone in the audience who brought this little book that after we talk, after this talk, I get to connect with this person who's sitting there in the audience, and I'm really excited about it. And I feel like oftentimes, you know, grief is hidden, and we're afraid to bring up someone's name after they die, and we're afraid we're going to make someone more sad. But the personal conversations that this has brought to me have actually been really amazing and make me feel less alone. You know, like grief is super lonely, and then it's also really communal. And so, like, my community of people who care about what happened to our family feels bigger, and then I also get to care about what happened to other people's families and talk about it. And then I'm also just super proud of Paul. You know, I still love Paul. I still feel so proud of Paul, and so to have, you know, like, feel this response that he would have loved to feel is really powerful and great.
I think there's a lot of us here, myself included, who are very inspired and feel like we're learning from watching you go through your grieving process. And you know, often with memories and life events that are painful, we don't talk about them. It's something that we've been talking about earlier today. And you wrote about them in unflinching detail in the epilogue. What was it like writing that epilogue?
It was super intense. It's kind of like exercising. It's like you don't love exercising, but you like having exercised. And like, I feel like writing is like that. Like, oh, I have to write. And then once you've written, you're like, my heart is on this page. You know, it feels so good to have that be true. Random House, the editor at Random House, when Paul died, the book was just a manuscript on his computer. It was like literally like an open Word document on his computer. And we had to do work to make sure it could be a book. And they said, you know, I think we need a close to the book. I think we'd like to ask you to write the epilogue. And at first I was like, I'm not a writer. I can't do it. I'm not even sure what I would say. I had all this, like, how would I do it? And then it kind of dawned on me that I think if Paul could have described his own death, it was part of the story, and I think he, like, used the word unflinching, right? It's like he would have done it, and I felt compelled to complete that part of the story. And then to just reflect on what's been happening since and on him, and it kind of taught me, having been a reader, it taught me, like, oh, this is why people write. Like, this is what it feels like to write and to share yourself, which is something I never anticipated wanting to do.
So this brings me to my main projection onto this book, which was, you know, I told you I read it a few times. I'm sure a lot of people here have, because there's so much to unpack. But, you know, the first time I read it, you know, you get to the epilogue, and I remember putting it down and telling my own wife, who was sitting next to me at the time, you know, it feels like this book was written by two different authors with one voice. It really struck me. And then I read it a second time, and for me, it felt like you were much more present in all of the silences in Paul's part of the book. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how going through this experience with Paul affected your relationship with him.
Mm-hmm. Somebody else decided to have a baby. Difficult decision. It's funny, it like brings tears to my eyes that you say the thing about sounding like one writer with different voices, because especially toward the end when Paul was really sick, we were like really fused. Like we could read each other really well, and we, you know, the beginning of the book talks about how we were having this difficult patch in our marriage. I've actually learned a lot about other people's marriages, having that out in the world. It's like really helpful, actually. It's really like eye-opening. So, but I think there, during the time of his illness, we unconditionally gave each other the benefit of the doubt. It just was like a byproduct of the intensity of the situation. And then there was a lot of stuff that was really fun, like my maternity leave. I was home, and then he was pretty debilitated and also home. And I think maternity leave can be a really lonely time, and it's like stressful and new. And in our house, it was like Paul was dying, and then Katie was growing, and the book was growing, and it was all this like really intense teamwork of like, we need each other for all of these different things. It was really wonderful. And then we had like nicknames for his medications. And it's just like, there's all this like tedium that you just kind of have to like figure out how to make, it just has to be part of your life. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, tell us a little bit more about that time and particularly how this book was assembled, because from what I understand, I mean, there are parts of the book that seem very intentionally parsimonious. These are four people I saw die, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then there are other parts where they just feel very rushed, like towards the end. I've read elsewhere that Paul didn't write it in this order. You told me today that some of my favorite parts of the book were lifted out of emails that he wrote, and that you had to think very carefully about whether they should be part of the manuscript. Just explain to us a little bit about how this became this.
So I'll just back up a little bit and say, like, the kind of story is that Paul, as you know, if you've read the book, went back to work as a neurosurgeon when he first got sick, but he started writing to help himself process what was happening, and he wrote this essay in the New York Times called How Long Have I Got Left, and had this surprising and great response to it, which included solicitations from literary agents and editors, which sort of opened up this lifelong dream that he hadn't thought he would be able to do. He made his way through most of the manuscript. The literary agent he worked with said, you know, oftentimes I tell people, you need to write the business case for the book you're thinking about writing, and you need to say, why is it different from Atul Gawande's book Being Mortal, and why is it, you know, how does it fit, and literally what's the business case? And she said, don't do any of it. Literally just don't worry about it, I'll do it. Just start writing. And that was really a gift in every way to him. And he had written, I mean, the book, it's not too different from what he left. The whole arc, the title, the epigraphs, In Perfect Health I Begin and Cease Not Till Death, which are from Walt Whitman's Song of Myself, all of that stuff is his. But after he died, the editor at Random House, Andy Ward, said, would it be possible for you to give me any intentional writing that Paul did? Like, literally, he said, literally, if in doubt, send it to me. Master's thesis, medical school application essay, like emails. We ended up saying, like, you're actually going to want some emails. And he's like, well, emails, like, what is it? But Paul had this kind of epistolary relationship with his best friend Robin, who lived in Singapore. And when they were together, they would make jokes. And when they were apart, they would write these long, really earnest emails to each other. And the part in the book that's about religion, Paul, that's from an email to Robin. Just like sort of excruciating, and that was actually one of the hardest ones. Andy said, you know, there's really beautiful, and Andy sort of cataloged everything. It took him like a couple of months, and then he said, these things are of a piece with what Paul has already written, and some of it was essays that Paul literally had meant to insert. The anatomy lab piece is actually something that he wrote in medical school, and he'd written in the manuscript, insert anatomy lab essay. So that was like, okay, easy, we can do that. But the Andy said, you know, this is really beautiful, this fits here, what do you think? And then there was some kind of simple logistical things where I would say, that's actually from the perspective of a senior resident, not an intern, so it's beautiful, but it can't actually go there. The religion part was the hardest because Paul actually hadn't written about religion in the manuscript, and so it was kind of a judgment call afterward to say, you know, does this fit? Should we put it in? But it was a piece of who he was, and so we decided to put it in. And I don't think that was a mistake. And 2 months after he died, Andy from Random House flew out to California and spent like, you know, 50 hours or something in our house. And he and I were in the living room. We went to visit Paul's grave. He had never met Paul, but he like weirdly knows Paul better than a lot of people who knew Paul. And then there were other things like the cover of the book. I had to help Random House sort of create it. And they have this amazing artists who read the book and then start designing a cover de novo, but they'll take sort of input on the sensibility. And so I said, it would be really great if it could be masculine and classic and timeless, but also stylish and not too trendy. And like, I literally was like, it has to be all these things. It like can't be anything less than like all of these things in a combination that really makes it, I felt so urgent. And this was the cover that ended up feeling right. And when they sent it back, it actually had all lowercase letters. So like, when breath becomes was lowercase. And at first it was like, oh, that's way too trendy. It feels like of a moment. And then she sent it back. And I was like, oh yeah, it's like, now it worked. I mean, they worked so hard they were so devoted to Paul and to the, you know, like, I think Andy felt equally strongly about keeping it. Like, there's a part in where he says something like, nothing describes better the look in a patient's eyes on receiving a serious neurosurgical diagnosis as the word disaster, which means a star coming apart. And the copy editor, they're like total geniuses. She was like, it technically doesn't mean a star coming apart. And it's like, and Andy was like, can we just keep star coming apart? And I was like, yes. So there was like, there's all this stuff that was like this detailed labor of love to like, honor Paul. And I think, it's not too different. It's just a little bit like thicker and, you know, like that's sort of what happened. I'd be interested to go look at the manuscript that he left. Maybe it would feel, I gotta look at it.
Fair enough. We've been instructed to hold our microphones closer, Lucy. Sorry to the people in the back. I have one more question and then I'm gonna turn it over to the audience, I think. But. One of the other things that really struck me about this, I mean, I feel like I got to know Paul pretty well too through reading this, and it, you know, he seems to have this very wry personality, like a really sharp eye for irony and paradox, and you know, he goes through a lot of experiences that everyone who goes through medical school and medical training goes through, but notices things and frames them, like the reverse polarity of the mannequin and the cadaver. It's like, that's genius. We totally pretend the mannequins are real and pretend the cadavers are fake. That's how we all do it. But then, you know, there are moments where he has these more profound realizations that seem ironic, but also somehow don't seem cynical. They seem, because you know, somehow like positive and maybe even helpful in getting through this. Like he talks about, you know, the paradox of how massive illness is supposed to be clarifying, for instance. And he talks about how you know, not so much because he knew he was going to die before. He still knows he's going to die now, but his lunch plans are shot to hell. And you know, then he like right from there he starts moving forward. He's like, if I got a week, if I have a month, if I have 3 months, then my plans are this, this, and this. And then you're like, oh, this is the way forward out of that. And it's not like a cynical defeatist thing. I mean, so the question of my ramble is, Do you feel that that's accurate? And did that help him? Was this part of how he was able to move forward, being able to turn things on their head?
Oh. What's the question exactly? Like, I think the answer is yes. I mean, he had a thing. Like
he had a thing.
Yeah. He had a thing.
He had a thing. Okay, that's good. On that note. Microphone.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, he like had a thing. Where, oh, okay. Oh, that's so much better. Can you hear now? Okay. Sorry about that. He was really good at seeing things sort of from different angles, like you say, like describing the total disorientation of being sick, but then being able to put one foot in front of the other, or find a metaphor in his writing where you're like, aha, it's like poetic, and it makes it feel less crushing. And he also, he was very, he like sort of was a contradictory person, like had internal contradictions, but one of them was this thing where it's sort of like everything is important, everything is sacred, and nothing is sacred at the same time. Or he was like highly irreverent and very reverent at the same time. And I think it was, you asked me today, like, was he always like super intense? And it's like, yes, the answer is definitely yes. But it wasn't that he was always working super hard. He also was like staying up all night drinking whiskey, or like he had a gorilla suit that he kept in the trunk of his car, and he said it's only for emergencies. And he like he just was like intensely alive all the time. And so I think like that ability of like noticing the little things, or drawing back to comment on the big picture, or being unflinching, and then you can't quite tell this in the book, but he was also like quite sentimental. It was like all of those were sort of wrapped together. And I think everybody's like that in a way, right? Or like you say, the book, some of the moments are really distilled, and then some of them are step back a little bit, and I think sort of how things go.
Great, okay, so I'm gonna turn it over to the audience now.
It's, a couple people have asked me that question, like, do you think he made himself sicker because he was sleep deprived while sick, or he was, you know, tired or, you know, working hard while sick? And I think, I don't know, I don't actually think so. I think there's probably actually the flip side, which is, I think feeling purposeful and feeling like your life matters is very sustaining. And I think that can be one of the hardest parts of being ill, is losing your identity, or you know, the existential pain that comes with the uncertainty and change in your identity that illness brings. So at the same time, I think it was a radical decision to go back to being a neurosurgeon. I think many people in this situation would really change what they're doing and may not return to work, and that's totally reasonable. And I was telling Neil when Paul and I got engaged, he was planning to be a psychiatrist. So I thought I was marrying this like scholarly literary psychiatrist, and then he surprised himself and me by being one of those people who loves the operating room, and obviously he loved the brain, and you know, loved these sort of critical crisis moments. And both of those are true in psychiatry, and they're true in neurosurgery. And I don't really understand people who love the operating room. It's like really cold in there, and your patient's asleep, and it's like, I don't know. But I think he was so like, he was so like compelled by what he could do for people. And I think he was technically interested in doing something that he found very difficult. And actually, when he returned to work despite his illness, I said that thing about like we started really giving each other the benefit of the doubt, and that was one of those situations. It's like whatever is going to make your life and your time meaningful, please do it, and please can I help you do it. It actually helped me sort of understand the depth to which he had considered the decision to switch from psychiatry to neurosurgery, the fact that he still wanted to do it in what we knew was likely limited time, like sort of astounded me even still. So it was almost helpful for me.
Yeah.
The question was, oftentimes medical training sort of beats out of you the ideals or empathy that you entered with, and then how has going through this experience with Paul sort of affected my own empathy? I think that when Paul first got sick, I had enough experience with seriously ill patients. There's this thing that happens in the hospital often when there are really hard decisions to make about medical care, and doctors call it the family meeting. And it's like, oh, we need to have a family meeting. And it's like, gather everybody and say, you know, here's what's happening, and we may only have tough decisions, and how are we gonna get through these decisions? And like, family meetings were one of my favorite things in residency. It's like, It's sort of this intense period for a family. And so even when Paul was first diagnosed, I was like, family meetings, like this is my thing. I'm like not afraid to like look away from what I think is gonna sort of unfold, the pain and uncertainty and the difficult, like I felt okay putting words on it. So I think the first step for me was the gift that being a healthcare provider gave me, to have a language to use and a framework to think about illness. And then I think coming out of it, the things that Paul talks about in the book where he says, it's so critical to understand your patients' values and who they are and what makes their life worth living and what would make their life not worth living. Whether it's a big or small medical decision, oftentimes, you know, knowing what it is that someone's actually worried about, or knowing, you know, what's the reason for whatever it is you need. It's just so ingrained in me now. And I also think these little statements of compassion from Paul's healthcare providers made such a difference. To me, I literally remember like sentences or words. And sort of like to all the medical people here, like no pressure, like the things you say, like could like really, you know, Paul's, when Tarceva stopped working for Paul and he was in that phase of give me 10 years, I go back to neurosurgery. And he was switching to give me 1 year, I'd write a book. Like he really actually defined those things and kept to that timeline. And his nurse practitioner in oncology came in and said, I was really hoping you were gonna be the guy who like got to be on Tarceva for a decade, and you're not that guy. And I was really hoping you were gonna be the guy. And it just was so nice. She said it and said, and you know, another person wrote us a condolence card. And I think there are these studies in medicine that are like, it's stuff that's really stark, like this is the way you don't get sued, or this is the way you don't burn out. And it's like, turns out like the answer to those is like, be a real person, and then you're less likely to get sued, and you're less likely to burn out. I mean, like that's what the research seems to show. So anyway, that's been helpful for me on both sides. And it's a hard thing. There's a sort of a weird, you go between, you sort of flip between these different states in medicine, but this has helped me.
A really quick follow-up to that. So there's, his oncologist seems to be an extraordinary person. And one of the sort of sacrosanct principles of medicine that this book complicates is this idea of patient autonomy, and like part of the empathetic process may actually be taking over some of the decision making. And what was that flip like?
I think it was, I mean, I think that was like an internal flip for Paul, right? That's sort of how I witnessed it. Is initially he felt a lot of responsibility to know everything and to double check everything. And we, you know, we knew the data on prognosis, and that was something she didn't want to talk about, but it was really helpful for us to actually have a sense of it. And you don't know where you fall on the line, but you know, it's useful to say, okay, months to a few years is what's likely. And you know, when we decided to have a baby, I needed that information to go into it with eyes open. But in the end, he felt like it was really helpful. And he, in a way, it was almost like he was like in love with his oncologist. And I don't mean that in like a weird way. I just mean like the dependency that he had, and the like the way that he needed her was so profound and actually sort of unexpected to both of us, I think. Because we thought like, oh, we're doctors or something. Like we can, like he talks about, I thought it would feel like being her colleague. And it didn't. It felt like we really needed her. And the question was, did he ever say, like, this is how I'd like to be remembered, or this is how I'd like to be grieved? I think the answer is kind of no, but I think the book was a huge part of it, that he felt like he was leaving something, especially for our daughter Katie, that tells her a lot about who he is, particularly his love for her, which is really crystalline at the end of the book. And you know, his the importance of striving is sort of really explicitly laid out and modeled. There are certain things he didn't talk about. He really was not, he didn't give me particular instructions about how to take care of his body after he died. So that, again, kind of like the decisions with the book felt like a very urgent decision. Like, and the decision was like, what would he have said? What would he have wanted? What fits him? What honors him? Without having his guidance, it was sort of like, what matches his sensibility? I was going to say one other thing. He talks about how right at the moment of diagnosis, probably was like literally within a half an hour, and he said, "I want you to get remarried," which was this very stark thing to say. It's sort of acknowledging I have a terminal illness, and I understand the weight of that, and then somehow I'm already thinking about you and what it's going to mean to you. It was this like really lovely thing to say, while at the same time it was completely heartbreaking. But I think he sort of gave me some messages like that about, in a way, that's sort of like a permission to have another future. And that feels really loving and kind. So I think that's part of the answer to the question, I think. So what has it been like for me going from being a private person to being a public person? Surprisingly positive. Partly because of that grief thing that I mentioned before. I have a twin sister who is a style blogger, who is like an open book online with lots of information about her family. She's sort of like a very, very public person and has been for almost a decade. And I never, ever, I was always like, that is so crazy. She's like, she shared that she had postpartum depression and she like has photos of her children there. And I just thought, I was like, that's not a thing that I would do. And then when Paul started writing, the response was so meaningful and positive. And I felt the same, that people, it's sort of this opportunity to enter into this sacred space with people and to feel connected. And similarly, there's a couple things that are kind of nice. One is when people are talking to me, especially in the media, nobody's like trying to be an investigative journalist and stump me. I did get the advice, like, if you cry, it's good TV. So like they made me try to like, it's kind of like, but then I've actually found that they're more likely to cry than I am because I'm so used to talking about it. it's been like really surprisingly helpful and positive in a way that I just would not have thought. And it also makes me feel like Paul and I are still a team, which is something that I really miss. So even though he's not here, the feeling of supporting him, I still feel deeply, which is nice for me. Oh, and then the part about my own voice, that's been surprising and interesting because I didn't realize at all that people would be interested in me. I just was so focused on completing the book for Paul and promoting the book for Paul. And then particularly around me being able to talk about end-of-life care in the US, which I think is one of the big challenges of our time, really makes me feel like I have a purpose stretching forward. And so that feels like really amazing to me. So how has going through this experience affected my relationships with my own patients, particularly since Paul died? So I haven't. Right now, I see patients at Stanford, but I don't have my own patients. I do general medicine outpatient, but more in an urgent care type setting. So I haven't had a patient die. I have diagnosed a couple people with serious illnesses. One with lymphoma, who was at urgent care for a minor symptom. That was interesting because that, I won't get too into the details of that, but Paul talks about this thing where he says in the book, he's talking about the importance of sort of discussing the emotional and experiential landscape of what a patient might go through if you have a sense of that and things look bleak to them, to lay out what they might expect or sort of the non-medical advice about coping. And then I also feel like in medical, like the same taboos exist in the hospital and medical care that exist in society, right? Like people are very scared to talk about prognosis on both sides. We don't really have a language around suffering and death or a comfort with like witnessing or just sitting in that space. And I think I became more used to doing that, and so now I feel like I'm better able to look people in the eye, so to speak, and just like be with them. At least I feel the experience feels different to me, and hopefully it's also helpful for patients. And that's an ongoing thing, I think, for everybody. So what other social norms or social situations did I sort of get insight into, particularly around uncomfortable situations, it sounds like? One thing that I found very helpful was friends or family who showed up and kind of continued to have the same types of relationships that we'd had before. And I guess the main thing I'm thinking of is people who who usually made jokes or like made fun of Paul continue to do the exact same thing. Because like when you're sick, you feel you're still you, but then you're in this different body that's betraying you in a way that you haven't experienced. And people tend to potentially treat you with kid gloves or be worried about seeing you or talking to you. And I think just people who continued to treat Paul the same way or was very helpful, especially jokes. And then my mom says this thing where she says, when in doubt, describe. And I actually think it's really good advice in the setting of grief or illness. And all she means, she gave it to us growing up. She would say, like, you know, if you're in an argument with somebody or something's, you know, you're upset, like literally just start describing it. And you can just say like, I'm so upset, I don't even know what to say right now. I'm really angry and I also feel hurt. Maybe we shouldn't talk about it, but can I just tell you, you know, just like literally just like start saying the thing. And I feel like some people did that around us when Paul was sick and I really liked it. They would say, they wouldn't be trying to say some perfect thing. Sometimes people literally said, I wish I knew what to say. I'm so happy to see you. I'm so sad this is happening. I wish I knew the right thing to say. And it's like, that is the right thing to say. So I think when in doubt, describe is another good one. Oh, yeah, it was Paul's writing voice similar to his speaking voice. Kind of no, and the reason I say that is he was able to write things. I think he was like extroverted and introverted in different ways, but he was actually able to write things that were more intimate or emotionally nuanced than what he was able to say out loud. So the manuscript that he was working on was an actual really important tool for us to communicate during the time that he was sick. Because I read it, like, I would be lying next to him while he was writing, like, not literally, like, word for word, but, like, I would read it daily or weekly. So in a way, no. Like, he was, like, a little bit more sort of jovial. And his friends that gave him that feedback, they were like, this book is so serious. that's like kind of the point. But then all the stuff like the some of the wit and then some of the just like literary or philosophical references that he would make. When I was first dating him, I would be like, note to self, look up this thing that he just said. So the question is, Paul had always sort of been on this struggle to find meaning, and how did that change when he was sick, or was it deepened or changed? I think not necessarily did it change. I think the things that he had found meaningful and helpful sort of just became brighter is, what I think is true. And one of his really good friends said, you know, I think that for Paul, the struggle to find meaning is the meaning of life. And I was like, oh yeah, I think that makes sense to me, actually. It's sort of a weird way to phrase it. But I think that was probably true and then was more strongly true when he was sick, just like his need for literature became like visceral and urgent when he was sick. There was this sort of other reverse version of it, which was it weirdly felt like these experiences that he had prepared him in a certain way to make sense of what was happening to his body, because he'd come at the question of, what does it mean to be human in all these different ways, primarily literature and medicine. And so to have both of those to draw on and have both of those in the book was, I think, toward the end of his life, that felt so compelling and personal that it was really, it really propelled him. The question was, when Paul got sick, did the fact that we and he had spent all this time training in medicine in a way that was not gonna bear the fruit we expected, did that cause regret? The answer is definitely no, and partly it's just you can't know what's gonna happen, so you just make the best decisions you can at any time. And then there's also, I think the answer Paul would have given, I sort of felt this instinctively, Janet Maslin wrote this book review of Paul's book in the New York Times, and she said something like, she talks about the arduousness of medical training and how he's just completely in it, and then she says right at the time that he was going to get to live, be done with his training, he needed to learn how to die instead. And I actually think Paul would have taken issue with it, because he would have said, well, during my neurosurgical training, I was living. Like, that was also my life. And every day and every moment, I was living those moments and found them meaningful. So maybe that's like the asymptotic answer, is like, it is meaningful. You're always living your life, even if you're projecting it into the future to get somewhere. I think that's what I would say. So you said doctors have especially surgeons have sort of a tactile relationship with life and death, which is a really beautiful, actually, thing to say. And then how did Paul's death and being in medicine sort of reflect back and forth in our lives? I'll answer this one a different way, which is, I think the experience of going through Paul's illness while being in medicine, I think allowed Paul a little bit of distance from it so that he could describe it and we could both look at it sort of for what it is. It was already in a context. It wasn't just like a cannonball coming out of nowhere, sort of like Paul made this joke one time where he said, and Christopher Hitchens in his memoir said something like, he called it his experience going to Tumor Town. And Paul was like, I've been in Tumor Town many times on a tourist visa, and now I'm a permanent resident of Tumor Town. And so I think, I'm not quite sure how to answer the question.
I'm wondering about your relationship with death and your husband's relationship with death and how that changed.
Yeah, okay, yeah. How our relationships with death changed. It's made it so much, I understand so much more deeply that death just is a part of life. It's not separate. There's not like the living and the dying, we'll all die, and until we die, we're all living. And I know it sounds stupid, but it's like, I feel this really visceral thing. And then I also think the experience of being doctors and facing this illness sort of shaped our relationship with death in a certain way, because we didn't ask the question of like, how could this happen? Why did this happen? Why me? Why now? I think we had a sense of like, this happens, shit happens, it happens really pretty randomly, it'll happen at some point to everyone. The sort of unfairness of death and illness I don't think of it that way anymore, which is actually kind of helpful. I saw this thing one time that said, pain plus non-acceptance of pain equals suffering. And I was like, oh, that's really, like, it took me a while to get my head around it, but I actually think that it's sort of gifted me that somehow, the extra level of suffering. So what is it like to be the surviving parent with Paul present and not? I feel a great responsibility, and I don't know what it's gonna look like, to help Katie shape a narrative about where she came from. Sometimes I'm like, is she gonna be angry that we had her knowing that her dad wouldn't be here? And I don't know, and I think similarly, helping her understand who Paul was, the book I think is very helpful to have for her as a gift, but maybe at certain times in her life she won't be interested in it or interested in him, and that's totally possible, and that might be even more painful for me. There's also this other weird contrast, which is she's so central to all of it, and my life and his life, but then she doesn't know any of what has happened, and our whole family is in a lot of pain, missing Paul, and she's not, but then she'll be in a different type of pain later. So I think it's sort of gonna be a challenge for me to try to figure that out. So I think, when in doubt, describe.
All right, Lucy, well, thank you so much for coming to Cambridge.
I had been writing his elegy in my head during the 7-hour drive there and trying not to. Thinking meant not thinking. It meant imagining my brother surrounded by light.